If you say that evolution began at the origin of life, then you're discounting all of the chemical and cosmic complexification that brought us to that point in which you could have the first living cell. How did it get there?
I always had this unsettled feeling that there was something missing from the laws of nature, because none of the laws explained all of the wonderful complexity of the universe around us.
For us, all evolving systems are conceptually equivalent, whether they're the evolution of atoms and isotopes, the evolution of minerals, or the evolution of life and technology, and so therefore may be described by a single unifying natural law.
So the law of increasing functional information is an effort to describe a kind of universal characteristic of the cosmos, the idea that systems over time appear to get more and more and more complex, more patterned, more diverse, more interesting, if you will.
And we characterize this increase in order through a metric called functional information.
We think information is as fundamental a variable in the cosmos as mass or energy or charge, which may be a little out there. So over the last 400 years or so, scientists have come up with a set of 10 laws. That's the canon of physics. And that it describes virtually everything we experience in our day-to-day lives. The motions, the forces, the energy, electromagnetism, the law of gravity. That's it.
The only law of those 10 macroscopic laws of nature that has an inherent arrow of time in it is the so-called second law of thermodynamics, which says that over time, a closed system's entropy should increase. Basically means that the disorder of the system should increase over time. But we see the second law manifest in our daily lives. Our new shoes get scuffed. You can break an egg and scramble it, but you can't unscramble an egg.
As I'm thinking, as electrons are moving, as molecule bonds are formed and broken, every one of those activities causes an increase in entropy. But that doesn't mean that entropy is driving complexification.
There is some extra description that is required to explain the marvelous creativity of everything that we see around us, and also the forces of complexification in everything else in the cosmos.
Go back to the Big Bang. There was really no structure of any kind. And then you started forming protons and neutrons, and then the protons and neutrons formed atoms, and then the atoms formed molecules, and the molecules formed stars, and the stars created planets. And minerals and atmospheres and oceans and ultimately life. And now life's creating language and art and various kinds of social structures and technologies. And now we have computer programs that themselves evolve. I mean, that's an incredible range of evolving systems, but they all share these three common aspects.
First, it must be composed of numerous diverse interacting components.
They could be atoms, they could be molecules, they could be cells, they could be individual people. And those different components can be arranged in just countless, vast numbers of ways.
Second, it has to have mechanisms for generating numerous configurations of those components.
You have to have a way of mixing things up, sampling new configurations. You have lots of different ways of arranging atoms or molecules or people. And then finally, you have to have some kind of selection pressure, selecting for a function.
In other words, they evolve. The most fundamental selection forces for us are selection for static persistence, dynamic persistence, and novelty generation. And in different systems, the selective force that matters the most could be different. Static persistence talks about the spatio-temporal continuity of arrangements of matter. So you can think about stable atomic nuclei or stable crystals. And eventually, a collection of those molecules may form a network that self-reinforces. In science, we call this an autocatalytic network, one with positive feedback loops. And that collection of molecules taken together is selected for its dynamic persistence, which applies to open systems, systems that are constantly exchanging matter, energy, and even information with their environment. Human beings, we're always exchanging molecules as we breathe and as we eat. And it's not the constituents of those systems that are persisting through time, but rather their activities, their functionality.
There is also selection at times for novelty, for doing something new, to be able to see or to fly or to swim or to walk on land. And those new characteristics allows you to persist and explore literally new spaces that you never could explore before.
But a critical distinction between life and minerals, the evolution of the atoms, life appears to be open-ended in its evolution, constantly exploring its new parameter and possibility spaces.
There is this kind of yin-yang between the idea of increasing disorder, increasing entropy, and at the same time, increasing information, increasing patterning. At the most basic level, I think of information as being described by something called Kolmogorov complexity. And that just means how many bits of information do you need to completely describe a system? Whether that's the words in a book, whether it's the genetic code, whether it's the information you need to make a mineral.
No matter how you jumble the components of that system, over time, the Kolmogorov complexity should remain the same. But we propose that over time, a different kind of complexity, a different kind of information, which we call functional information, actually increases over time for systems that are evolving. The metric functional information was first introduced by Nobel Prize winner Jack Szostak in 2003, thinking about the functionality of biological molecules. This was later applied to additional systems like artificial life and language. And then when we were thinking about what metric to use for a law of evolution that can apply to both biological and non-biological systems, we decided that functional information might be a useful metric. The functional information of a system is characterized by two numbers, the total number of configurations that that system can partake in, and the number of configurations of that system that actually perform the function of interest. And so you get a fraction when you divide one number by the other.
So there's a little bit of math involved, but the math is pretty straightforward. And you just think of it. The rarer something is, the higher its functional information. As you're ratcheting up more and more function, the functional information goes up.
You can see the functional information increase over time in numerous natural and artificial systems.
You can actually calculate it.
For instance, we can watch as the complexity in terms of functional information of Earth's mineralogy increases over time.
So a mineral is just defined as a naturally occurring solid that has a well-defined chemical composition and a well-defined atomic structure. The first minerals would have occurred in very old stars. And as that star's atmosphere begins to expand and cool, you start condensing out about 25 tiny minerals. They're stardust, and those go on then to seed the universe with the materials that form planets. And planets can then do new things. And when Earth becomes alive, that opens up whole new ways, whole new processes to make more minerals. So while the number of minerals is increasing, the combinatorial possibilities are increasing much, much faster. There are 72 different kinds of chemical elements that help form minerals. So how many different combinations and permutations are there of those atoms? And it's something like 10 to the 46th power, an unimaginably large number. It's finite, but it's a very, very large number. And of all those different possible combinations, only a tiny, tiny fraction actually form stable minerals. Only 6,000 minerals are actually found. And it's because nature selects for those configurations that persist. And most configurations fall apart. So now we have the negative log to the base 2 of 6,000 over 10 to the 46th power. And that gives us the number of bits of functional information. The functional information of minerals on Earth today is about 142 bits.
But we can also see the functional information of artificial life in computer simulations increase over time. We can see the functional information of organic molecules increase over time in laboratory experiments. What our framework does allow us to do is identify and explore environments in our solar system that may have been selected and evolved in a similar manner that give us these three essential ingredients for an evolving system. Places that we're looking include Jupiter's moon Europa and Saturn's moon Enceladus, and of course Saturn's moon Titan, where there are these interactions between hydrospheres and geospheres that can provide the raw ingredients, the free energy to sample different configurations of those ingredients, and potentially also selection pressures that will cause those systems to evolve in functional information over time.
If there's going to be pushback for our ideas, it's always going to be the point of the second law is enough. The second law of thermodynamics is all you need to explain time. But we tried that game. Let's take the second law of thermodynamics and try to explain the origin of life. And it just doesn't work as far as we're concerned. There has to be something else. And that's because systems ratchet themselves up with this increase in functional information through selection. It's consistent with, but it's different from the second law of thermodynamics. This is very tempting to think about this idea in terms of, well, we're selecting for function and this ratcheting up is something that's being driven in some way with a purpose, but we don't think of it that way at all. And it's really important to make this point. Think about gravity. Without gravity, we wouldn't have stars and planets. But the purpose of gravity is not stars and planets. The purpose of the law that we're proposing is not to create conscious brains that can think about the cosmos. That is just one of the outcomes of matter interacting in this way. But it's not a complete theory yet.
I mean, we could always be completely wrong.
Maybe some scientists will see the tragic flaw that we have and will say, here's why it's wrong, and then it'll go into the dustbin of history. And we'll see, our law is going to be subject to the same kind of selective pressure.
Our theory itself will evolve, perhaps according to the law of increasing functional information.
Yeah.
This is just the beginning.